This is your chance to finish the sentence you're talking. All right. Welcome to Hillcrest Bible Church. For those of you online, thank you so much for joining us. I'm sure you're in for a real treat. For those of us who are in this sanctuary, you're going to be blessed. I have a couple announcements. First of all, rumor has it there's many new people from overflow of Easter from last week, and so we're glad that you tried us a second time. So welcome to the new members or new people who are here. We thank you for giving us another opportunity to be with you. Also, this is really a monumental Sunday, which you probably don't even know it, but this is this Sunday that we have two services where we offer childcare. So if you see Erin, make sure you thank her for her hard work. She is an amazing addition to this church. And that's not a small feat. It's a huge undertaking, and she's done a phenomenal job. So we praise God for Erin. And then because there's this woman I live with, there's a women's ministry weekend, April 30th through May 1st. She's got something up her sleeve, and you won't want to miss it. I've been watching her really work diligently for months so that she can actually, proclaim God's word in a different way. And so you really don't want to miss that. If you're a woman, if you're a man, volunteer to take the kids. You'll be, you'll have a different wife when you come back. So it was 1989, the roughest year of my life. I was supposed to be married. That blew up. I had a good job. That blew up. I had to move home from Arizona and rent my old bedroom from my parents. Very humbling experience. About 4 months into that, I got invited to a church in Sycamore, Illinois that was jam-packed with people, seeing Huntley Brown, who I'd never heard of before. In his young 20s, he had an incredible impact on my life. I saw a man who not only plays the piano, but has the Spirit of God that's so evident. So I thought to myself, how can I encourage this man? Because he certainly encouraged me. I bought some CDs for my parents, so neither one of them were musical, but I swear I heard those CDs all the time. A couple years later, when my mother-in-law came into my life, I bought her some CDs, and I think they wore out. And I watched this man go through Billy Graham Crusades as a lead piano player. He's been all over the world. Literally every year or two, he goes all over Russia, Kazakhstan. He's been to England, Russia. He's been in Japan, China. He's been Estonia, South Africa. He's been in Czechoslovakia and even Switzerland. And so many more I won't even mention. Been very gifted to work with people like Michael W. Smith, Nicole C. Mullen, George Beverly Shea, Cliff Barrows, names that are just so incredible in our Christian world. He's an ordained pastor, and watching him just develop over 30 years has just been a joy. He didn't know me at all. About 3.5 years ago, I got a phone call from my son, Luke. Many of you in this room, we should thank because you had an impact on Luke in this church as we watched him grow up in the stage. He's a freshman at Judson University. He called me and said, "Dad, I'm taking some piano lessons." He never had piano lessons in his life, even though he played quite a bit. He said, "But Dad, I'm learning more than a C flat seventh chord. I'm learning about how to be a minister through the gifts that God has given me." I said, "Who's teaching you that?" He said, "Huntley Brown." And I dropped the phone. Oh my goodness. What an amazing opportunity. For whatever we paid for tuition, it was worth it on that phone call. And I will tell you this, for the last 3.5 years, we owe an eternal gratitude to Huntley Brown for impacting my second son. He's been all over playing with Huntley. In fact, Friday night they have a gig about an hour concert. It's the head of the worship and arts director of the whole college, Dr. Anderson, playing the bass, Huntley Brown on the piano, and Luke on the drums. And he's been able to do that for his entire career. He went to Europe with Huntley, and Huntley's had just a huge impact. So, you know, all over the world, we called him and said, how'd you like to come to Oregon, Wisconsin? Check the box. But he's more than just check the box kind of guy. He loves his creator so deeply. He's so committed to his Savior and Lord that he does this just because he can make an impact on people. I'm telling you, you are in for a real treat. So let's give a warm Hillcrest welcome to Mr. Huntley Brown.
Lift your voices. Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you, thank you, thank you, and to God be the glory. What a mighty God we serve. God is good. And all the time. One more time. God is good. And all the time. We do serve a wonderful God. And it's truly an honor and a privilege to be here. And I want you to do me a favor. Turn to the person on your right, the person on your left. Simply say to them, neighbor, I am so glad you can see me again. Yeah, I'm so glad you can see me too. But we're going to have a wonderful time lifting up the name that is above every other name. Amen? Amen. Now, I have developed a reputation of doing strange things to pianos. And by the way, Rick, I promise I'll be on my best behavior. I'm going to leave the piano in one piece. I'm going to try. Okay. Now, I have broken keys, broken strings, broken foot pedals, but I never broke a piano bench in my life until I got to Korea. Take a look at the screen. You see what I mean?
Chanyara! Chanyara! Chanyara!
Hallelujah. Well, that's it. And they promise that this bench is going to hold me up. All right. So everybody, go ahead and stand on your feet. Let's worship the Lord. The song says, "Amazing Grace." This is Amazing Grace. Let's worship the Lord. This is Amazing Grace. You laid on your life. Lift your voices. Amazing Grace. You laid down your life. Thank you. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Worthy is the Lamb. This is amazing grace. Amen. You may be seated. This is amazing grace. We give God thanks for his goodness, for his greatness. This hymn says, my Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. Worship with us. Sing.
My
mansions of glory. Thank you. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. You know, friends, I love Jesus. I'm going to tell you, you know, I am a testimony waiting to happen. Anywhere I go, I am ready to testify in 2 seconds, all right? And yesterday we had the most amazing time, you know, at, you know, Rick and Michelle's house. And we had the worship team and Pastor David over. All the folks were there last night. Stand up. Let me see you guys. Just stand up where you guys are. Stand up. So they can give him a hand, by the way. Go ahead. Stand up. All you guys were there last night. Stand up. Yeah, stand up. You too. Stand up. Yeah. Me, these guys are literally amazing. You know, I can take you. We can go anywhere. But, you know, as a matter of fact, you know, I have good news and bad news. Here's the good news. For a long time, I've been looking for a choir to travel with me. Last night, I discovered the choir. So they're going home. You guys are going to pack. We're going to hit the road. Just wave bye-bye. They're gone. Okay. But we had the most amazing time yesterday. And by the way, Michelle, you need to repent for that dessert you had afterwards. You know, that dessert you had, that brownie and the other strawberry, something, something, something over something. Let's have a moment of silence and pray. But that was some good stuff. Anyway, but I just give God thanks for this church. And, you know, Rick mentioned his son Luke, you know, many years ago. I remember someone told me about looking at Michael W. Smith and seeing that God is going to use him globally. And I see the same with Luke. This young man is special. God has some amazing things in store for Luke. And he came from a solid foundation here. You guys should all be proud of what Luke is accomplishing and what God's going to use him to do. Now, last night at the house, we were talking about Tbilisi very briefly. So I brought a quick video clip because they were asking about some of the places I've been at, some of the difficult situations we have been in, where our lives have been threatened. You know, we talked about, you know, before I play this video, I got to share one short story. I was sharing stories all last night, okay? But I got to tell you one quick story before I play Tbilisi. Many years ago, I was in Coventry, England, with the Billy Graham Association. I met this pastor, and he said to me, Huntley, would you like to come to Ireland sometime? I said, sure, anytime. I didn't think he was serious, okay? So I came back home. We're living in Aurora, Illinois right now. Got a call. He said, Huntley, can you come to Ireland? I said, sure. So he flew myself and my wife over, went to Ireland, did a tour, amazing experience. Then he called me back, and he said, okay, Huntley, I have an idea. I'm like, uh-oh, what kind of idea do you have? Now, he said, Huntley, I want to do a concert of peace, and I want you to be the featured artist. I said, say that again? You're talking about Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland who are blowing each other up, and you want to put little Jamaica me in the middle? Anyway, it was a God thing. We did the first concert. It was amazing. I mean, when I say literally amazing, and it grew. When I said the thing grew, 1 year, Queen Elizabeth sent her band over. The President of the United States sent a delegation over. 1 year, years ago, you may remember a guy named Yasser Arafat from Palestine. He sent a team over. So you have Israelis, Palestinians, Jews, Muslims, Christians, everybody on the same roof in Ireland. And friends, I am telling the media, the last concert we did, I remember the media saying to us, what in the world are you guys doing? Now, we had the Queen's band from England on the same stage with the top Irish band. It would be like bringing the Israelis and the Palestinians together on the same stage. Yeah, that's basically what it would have been. But over the years, we literally saw the walls come down and peace came to Ireland. Friends, anytime people ask me, Huntley, what would be one of the one things you stand at your list, top of your list, that would be one. There are a few, but that is one. I literally saw a nation transform. Sometimes study the Irish peace process. I'm not saying we did it. It's a God thing, okay? But just to have been there and see the whole thing is amazing. But anyway, we went to Tbilisi, Georgia, and when we got there, man, they did not want us over there. They did not want a gospel. They did not want Franklin Graham. And I mean, they set a fire to the building, threats the whole nine yards. But guess what? You know, you do what you do. Why? Because you love Jesus. Amen? And you love him too. So go ahead and run the video from Tbilisi and we'll continue.
I'm Franklin Graham, and right now we're in Tbilisi in Georgia. And this is a small country that's on the eastern end of the Black Sea, just north of Turkey. It's an ancient country with a lot of history. We have been asked by 150 churches to come and to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. First time that these churches have ever cooperated for anything like this. And we're to be meeting right behind me, and this is their sports stadium. He said there was a fire a couple of days ago that is preventing us from using this hall. There was smoke and a little bit of water damage. But every place we went, looking for another venue, plazas, parks, other stadiums, every place we went, they said, no, no, no. The media has said you have very powerful and strong forces working against you. I believe we probably have more opposition here in this part of the world than any place we've ever been before. Well, guess what? We've got a very strong and powerful God that's working for us. And we're taking our festival to a small church. They have a patio in the back, a little plaza. So we're going to pack and jam it. And it's going to be exciting to see what God is going to do.
This is kind of exciting. It's not exactly what we had planned, but there are many people outside.
Люди и на улице за пределами нашего здания.
And even some protesters.
Даже есть те, кто протестует.
We want them to hear the gospel.
Мы тоже хотим, чтобы они услышали Евангелие.
There's so many stories I could share, and when Franklin gave the altar call, so many people raised their hands to accept Christ. But we do what we do because we love Jesus. I want to make a difference in the lives of other people. You know, before I get into the word this morning, I want you to talk to me. When you think of God, what words come to your mind? Anybody? Anyone? Awesome. Yes? Some more? Father, yes? More? You highlight? Yes? Any more? Man, you guys are preaching good. All right, now here's what we're going to do. We're going to put all those words together in this worship song to the Lord. Many times people say, Huntley, what's your favorite song of praise and worship? This one is it. This song says, Lord, you are holy. Holy is your name. Over and over, the songwriter says, I thank you, I thank you, I thank you. Then at the 3-minute mark, can you wait for 3 minutes? Say, yeah, man. Yeah. Come on, you pretend like you're Jamaican, man. Say, yeah, man. Yeah, at the 3-minute mark, that's when it gets really good. That's when the songwriter says, you are wonderful, glorious, holy, and righteous, victorious, conqueror, triumphant, and mighty, healer, deliverer, shield and defense, strong tower, and my best friend, omnipotent, omnipresent, soon coming king, Alpha, Omega, Lord of everything, holy, holy is his name. Let's worship together. Lord, you are holy. Father, we love you. We bless you. We praise you. We worship you. We honor you. We declare that you are God all by yourself. We declare that you are good, that you're wonderful, you're awesome, you're mighty, you're powerful, you never change. And Father, I just want to just brag about you a little bit and just tell everybody how good you are, how wonderful. Lord, what a privilege it is to come into your presence, to join the angels who circle the throne saying, holy, holy, what an awesome God you are. We can't tell you thanks enough for being so good to all of us, for your mercy, for your grace, for your blessings. And Father, I just want to just thank you. Just want to just sit here for a little bit and just worship and honor you for who you are. You have truly been a great, wonderful, awesome, amazing Heavenly Daddy. I pray you speak through me this morning in a profound way that lives will be transformed for your kingdom. Amen. What a mighty God we serve, eh? You know, we do serve a wonderful, great, powerful God. And like I mentioned to Pastor this morning, you guys can invite me back here anytime on the one condition. Yes, you can clap. You can go ahead and clap. Yes. That's if I get to get hang out with the same guys I hung out with last night and we can get that same dessert again, the dessert you made. Okay, yeah. But next time we have to have some bread pudding. Is that all right? All right, well, if you have your Bibles, open them to Mark chapter 10. And today we are going to study very briefly lessons from the life of Bartimaeus. Lessons from the life of Bartimaeus. Mark chapter 10, verses 46 to 52. Then they came to Jericho as Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city. A blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. In studying the life of Bartimaeus, we are not given too much information. We're told he's blind, he's a beggar, and his name literally means son of Timaeus. But apart from that, we do not have a lot of information. But after carefully examining this passage, I discovered that there are some hidden truth. And if we extracted these truth and applied to our lives on a daily basis, they will make us more effective Christians. Lessons from the life of Bartimaeus. Lesson number one. You don't determine your future. You determine your habits, and your habits will determine your future. Let me say that once more. You don't determine your future. You determine your habits, and your habits determine your future. If you want to know what your future is going to look like, take a look at your habits right now. In the case of Bartimaeus, I believe he had a habit of listening. And you might say to me, "Huntley, come on. That is real elementary preaching." Yeah, come on now, Huntley. The man was blind. What do you expect? He had to listen. And you are 100% right. But I discovered you can be listening and not really listening. You know, like I said, the first service, is it okay if I make a confession? Can I confess, my friends? Can I confess this morning? Okay, I'm going to make a confession here, okay? Now, many times I've been at home having a conversation with my wife. And I'm saying, "Yes, dear. No, dear. Yes, dear." And then halfway through, she'll stop. She said, "Okay, honey, what did I just say?" I look up. "Why are you asking me what you said? You know what you said. Why do you want me to tell you what you said? Come on now, you know what you said. She looked at me like, you were not listening, were you? I see all the ladies here smiling, right? Ladies, you hit your husband and say, that's exactly what's wrong with you. And the truth is, I was caught. I really wasn't listening, even though I was amen, caught her saying amen to what she was saying. Now, friends, here's why this is important. When you listen on a certain level, sooner or later, you are going to hear something that is life transforming. You know, it's almost like reading. Have you ever read a certain passage of scripture? And then one day you are reading the exact same passage and you say to yourself, wow, I have never seen that before. My goodness, let me give one example of this, okay? Romans chapter 8 verse 11 says, and if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who lives in you. Wow. You know, friends, there are no words to describe what we just read. We just celebrated Easter last week. And the passage is saying to us, the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, the same one is here right now. In me, in you, in all of us who name the name of Christ, the exact same spirit that was there when Jesus rose from the dead is here. Friends, when you go home, take some time to think about that one. It will change your life. And I firmly believe that Bartimaeus was listening on this level all the time. And he heard something that produced faith in him. And the question is, how did Bartimaeus get faith? How does anyone in general get faith? The answer is found in Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Romans 10, 17 says, faith cometh by what? And hearing by what? Man, you guys have been in church. One more time. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by? So if you want more faith, get more word. Because faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So Bartimaeus obviously was hearing something that produced faith in him. And if we're going to take the Bartimaeus story, and we're going to translate it into Oregon, Wisconsin, 2021, you know, I can see the story going something like this, you know. I can see Bartimaeus taking a trip all the way to Green Bay, you know, to Lambeau Field, okay? And he's outside waiting for the Packer game with his radio, you know. And Bartimaeus outside chilling, and all of a sudden, Pastor Dave and Rick walks up. Barty, how you doing? Man, I'm just here chilling. And by the way, Pastor Rick, will you join me in praying for the Packers? The Packers need some prayer. Last year, I thought they were going to the Super Bowl. I don't know what happened, but Pastor, we have to fast and we got to pray because we love our Packers. Anyway, Pastor Dave said, okay, but Bartimaeus, I have great news for you. Guess what? You know, last week we went downtown Chicago, went to Orchestra Hall, all right? We already had this Jamaican piano player named Huntley Brown playing. So Rick and myself went to go check him out. But guess what happened? Before the concert even began, a man named Jesus walked up. Do you remember Blind Fred? Yeah, oh, Blind Fred, yeah, we used to beg together. Jesus touched Fred's eyes, and Fred can see. Oh, come on, Pastor Dave. Why are you trying to get my hopes up? I am going to file a complaint with your church when I get back. I'm going to call your wife. I'm going to have to talk to her, talk about you. You're trying to get my hopes up. But Pastor Dave said, but Bartimaeus, we're telling you the truth. There's a man in town named Jesus who touched Fred's eyes. Fred can see. I can imagine Bartimaeus saying to himself, if what they are telling me is true, this means one thing. Jesus is the son of David, meaning he is the Messiah. And I believe Bartimaeus was saying to himself, if I ever hear that Jesus is anywhere close to here, he's going to know I'm here. And when that realization hit Bartimaeus, it leads us to lesson number two. Lesson number two. When opportunity knocks, that is not the time to prepare. When opportunity knocks, that is not the time to prepare. What do you want to do with your life? Do you want to start a business? Do you want to go into ministry? Do you want to be a musician? Whatever you want to do, now is the time to prepare. I believe Bartimaeus may spend some time at night dreaming, thinking, what would it be like to get into the presence of Jesus? And if I ever hear he's in town, he's going to know I am right here. I can see Bartimaeus thinking about it over and over again. And then one day, Bartimaeus hears a sound. And he says, what's going on? Maybe someone just casually said, oh, Bartimaeus, not a big deal. Just a man named Jesus is passing by. Who? Oh, a big deal, Bartimaeus. Just a guy named Jesus. You mean the Jesus that my friend Pastor Dave and Rick told me about, who healed Fred's eyes? That Jesus is passing by? And the scriptures say he started to scream, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. He started to scream. Why? Because Bartimaeus is saying, I have waited for this moment and I am not going to let this moment slip by, because you have to prepare in advance before you get there. He was prepared. And Bartimaeus started screaming. And the scripture uses a very strong word. It says they rebuked him. That's a strong, I hate that word. That's a strong negative word, rebuke. But very important, they rebuked Bartimaeus. Why? Because they said he was acting undignified. And they tried to get Bartimaeus to be quiet. But Bartimaeus wasn't screaming before. It's now he starts screaming, Jesus! Jesus! Ah! He started jumping. Bartimaeus started carrying on. Why? Because of lesson number 3. In order to get some miracles, you need to be desperate. How desperate are you this morning to see God work in your life? In your home, in this church, in this city, in this country? How desperate are you today? What are you willing to do? In scripture, we read about many people who were desperate. In 1 Samuel, we have Hannah. 1 Samuel chapter 1. Why was Hannah desperate? She could not have any kids. And she was desperate for a baby. And she went to church, and in her desperation, she prayed. And when she prayed, the pastor, I call him the pastor, thought she was drunk. Think about that. The preacher thinks she was drunk. And he confronted her and walked right into lesson number 4. Perception is not necessary reality. You can perceive something, but that does not mean it's true. And the case of the preacher, he thought she was drunk. And he confronted her, but she said, no, I'm not drunk. I'm simply pouring out my heart to God. What kind of a prayer was Hannah praying? A desperate prayer. And then something amazing happened in 1 Samuel 1 verse 17 to 18. It says this, Eli answered, go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him. She said, may your servant find favor in your eyes. Then she went her way and ate something, and her face was no longer downcast. Very interesting passage. Hannah went to church depressed. She went to church desperate for a baby. She prayed a prayer that the preacher thought she was drunk, and he confronted her, and then he said to her, may God grant you what you have asked of him. And it says she left church, and her face was no longer downcast. You know, I got to share a quick story that happened a couple of years ago. At a church Sunday morning, and there's a couple in our church we're praying for them to have children. And I mean, miscarriage after miscarriage after miscarriage, just nothing going on. Anyway, the wife got pregnant, and we got excited. Oh, man, we're happy. So I get to the church, and the pastor said to me, well, Huntley, before service begins, the worship team gathered together. And he said, can you pray for the service? I said, sure. So I started praying for the service. And in my prayer, I asked God to bless mother and bless baby. All of a sudden, the husband started crying. and I did not know what happened. Man, what is going on? So I finished praying. The pastor calls me aside. He said, Hunter, come here. He said, I know you did not hear, but his wife lost the baby. And friends, something hit me. We were like, man, God, man, I am desperate, God. You know, my wife and myself, we have four kids, by the way. We have Natalie, Natasha, Nicole, and Nadia. My wife says the next one is called No More. We're done, okay. So when it comes, I just love kids. You know, anyway, you know, when kids start screaming, that's where I'm. I just want to be around kids. I just love them. Love my kids dearly. And I just believe that God wants us to raise the next generation to have an impact for his kingdom. So I just encourage people all over the place, man, you invest in the lives of the young people. So I was desperate for this couple to have a baby. And I'm saying, Lord, what's going on? So I said to the couple, okay, don't leave. I called a few people from church and said, okay, guys, we're desperate. We're going to believe God. No, guys, you have to understand this. God has to be God. It's not. We're not talking about a candy cane God. He can't put God in a box and he just give you wishes. We're not talking about that, okay? God has to be God. But our responsibility is to step out in faith and trust him for what he says he's going to do. So I called a few people together and said, okay, guys, we are going to pray. We're going to believe. We're going to believe that by the stripes of Jesus, this person is healed. We're going to ask God to intervene. We know it's a spiritual healing, yes. But also I believe that God can heal you physically as well. So after church, we gathered together. We laid hands on the couple. We prayed. A year later, they had a baby. I think they're up to... Amen. You can clap to that, yes. I think we're up to baby number three now. Okay. No. And before I finish this, I got to share one other story to build faith. I'm in Michigan, okay, and I'm at a concert. And a pastor comes to the concert, and he and his wife cries through the whole concert. I mean, literally weep. So I have no clue what happened or what I did. What did I do? You know. But anyway, a year later, I discovered what happened. The pastor and his wife could not have any kids. They were trying for a long time. They were pleading with God. And then the pastor's wife met this other pastor who said, why don't you stand on a certain verse and just believe God? Stand on faith. And she said, really? Okay, so they found a verse. And the pastor said this, I'm not going to believe unless I hear the verse three times. So he went to church, and their pastor, without even knowing, mentioned the verse. And his wife is excited. Honey, hear the verse. He said, No. I got to hear that verse three times in order to even believe that. I drive in from Illinois to Michigan, having no clue. In the middle of my concert, out the clear blue, I said, just say this verse. Boom, I said the verse. And they cried. A year later, he had the baby. And I was in Michigan 2 years ago. He preached, and he stopped his service. He said, Huntley, I want you to meet your miracle. Here comes this 6'8" guy. Almost as handsome as me. Just kidding. Handsome guy walked down the aisle. He was getting married. I was busy, couldn't make his wedding. But what happened? They were desperate. And they stepped out in faith. This morning, what are you desperate for? Is there something in your heart right now that you're desperate for? You're asking God to do. Bartimaeus was desperate. And that's why he screamed, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And there are many scores of people who have been desperate. Now, my favorite story of desperation in the Bible is from the book of Mark. Now, here's why I love this story, okay? Because of time, I'm going to run along with this story. These guys had a friend who was sick. They called him a paralytic. They heard about Jesus. They said, let us bring our friend to Jesus because Jesus can heal him. So they got to the meeting, and when they got to the meeting, problem. The meeting was full, and they could not get in. And they said, what are we going to do? We have to get our friend to Jesus. And somebody said, you know what? Let us take off the roof. They literally took off the roof and let their friend down to Jesus. Now, friends, after thinking about the story, my question was, whose bright idea was this? To take off the people's roof. after thinking about it, I said, you know what? These guys must have been Jamaicans. You know, only in Jamaica would we do something this crazy. You know, I came from Jamaica in 1984. And in 1988, I was on campus at Judson. And they were having the Winter Olympics. You remember? Yes. And I'm watching TV. And all of a sudden, the announcer came on. And he uttered words I never heard in my life, or you. And the announcer came on and he said, "And now for the Jamaican bobsled team." You know, I looked up and the first question we had was, "What's a bobsled?" When we discovered what a bobsled was, we said, "Where do they train?" Friends, in Jamaica, the coldest it gets is 60 degrees and we're freezing. A bobsled, you put on ice. I mean, what happened? But after thinking about it, I realized, I think I know what happened. You know, in Jamaica, they have some stuff you are not supposed to be smoking. They're trying to make it legal here. You are not, just say no, okay? And I think my friends must have been on the beach. They say, okay, guys, they're having Winter Olympics. We are desperate. We want to go. Jamaicans, we do not like to be left out. We want to go. What should we do? I can see a guy go, "Yeah, man. Yeah, man. We should be bobsledding, man. Yeah." No, friends. They made it. No, I have no idea how they train or whatnot, but guess what? They made it. There's a movie, by the way. Watch a movie called Cool Runnings. True story. I'm sure there's some embellishment, but it's a true story. But why did the Jamaican bobsled team make it? Because they were desperate. And why would you make it? Because you're desperate. And Bartimaeus was desperate, and he kept screaming, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stopped, and Jesus said, "Bring that man to me." Bartimaeus threw his cloak off and he ran to Jesus. And when he gets to Jesus, Jesus asked him a question that puzzled me a long time. I just could not understand why Jesus asked the question. Jesus said to Bartimaeus, "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus, what kind of a question is this? Isn't it obvious? Doesn't the entire world know that Bartimaeus wants to see everyone but Jesus? And I discovered the answer finally in lesson number 5. Lesson number 5. Jesus wants us to be specific. Jesus wants you to be specific. Bartimaeus could have wanted money. He could have wanted food or clothing. So Jesus was saying to Bartimaeus, "What do you want me to do for you?" Friends, in closing this morning, if those doors should open and Jesus should come right here and stands right here and he looks across this audience at each person and he says to you individually, "What do you want me to do for you? What is on your heart today? What would you want to talk to Jesus about? Are you here depressed? Are you here dealing with suicidal thoughts? Are you here, are you sick? Are you struggling with an addiction? It could be drugs, alcohol, pornography. It could be anything. And you're here saying, you know, "Huntley, I just want to talk to Jesus about this because I am trying." Maybe you're here angry with God. You're saying, "God, why did you allow my friend or my loved one to die?" Or you're going through a divorce. Or you're just depressed. What is going on in your life right now that you'd want to talk to Jesus about? Go ahead and bow your heads quickly for me. Just bow your heads. This morning, in the stillness of the moment, just talk to God individually. Tell him exactly what is on your heart. Jesus is saying to you today, "What do you want me to do for you?" Present your request to him. Father, we thank you that we can come into your presence about anything at any time. Lord, I do not know what my brothers and sisters are going through this morning. Father God, I do not know those who are here who are depressed. Those who are here struggling with addictions, God. Those who are here saying, Lord, no one knows what I'm doing or what I'm going through, but you know. And God, can you help me? Those who are here saying, God, can you give me another chance? Those who are here saying, God, I am angry. Why would you allow this to happen to me? Father God, whatever the needs are, whatever the case may be, I'm going to ask you, God, to intervene. Lord, for those who cannot sleep, I pray, God, that you'll wrap your arms around them. For those who have no peace, God, I pray, God, that they'll sense your peace like never before. And Lord, I pray, God, that this week people have encounters with you that would be life transforming. So, Father, I thank you that you're a God who hears and answers prayer. And I give you thanks, praise, glory, and honor for what you have done and for what you're getting ready to do. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. This morning, in closing, I'd like to leave a song with you that simply says, because he lives, you can all face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know who holds your future. Life is worth the living because Jesus lives. Go ahead and stand on your feet. Let's worship the Lord together. Because he lives. Sing, God sent his son. Because he lives. Then one day, thank you. Remember, no matter what you're going through, no matter how difficult the day, how dark the hour, you can make it, you can make it, you can all make it. Why? Praise God. Jesus lives. God bless you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. You may be seated for 1 second just before you run. Just want to say a big thank you to everyone for coming out this morning. God bless you. I look forward to coming back in the future under one condition. That's if Michelle is going to make that wonderful dessert again, plus bread pudding, and you guys are going to come and sing. Amen. Also, if you would like to take me home with you, you can do so. Or we have CDs available. Just take a look at the table. My favorite one on the table is Lord, You're Holy. Let's take a look. Also, we have a website, huntleybrown.org. Or if you're on Facebook, look me up. We have 2 pages, the Huntley Brown Ministries page, just like, or my personal page. You can send me a request and we can become friends that way. Keep us in your prayers as we travel, spread the gospel. We just want to change lives for God's kingdom. Amen. So go ahead and stand on your feet, receive the benediction as we leave this morning. And before we go, will you give a quick round of applause to the guys running sound and the TV? Give them a hand. You guys were dynamite. And also give a quick round of applause to Pastor David. This man is one mean preaching machine. And family, bless you. And also to Michelle and Rick and family, give them a hand. Thank you so much. God bless you. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord wrap His arms around you and cause you to sense His peace like never before. Jesus saying to you, whatever you are going through, trust me, lean upon me, depend on me. I promise you, I will never leave you or forsake you. So, Father, I thank you that you are never going to leave us or forsake us in spite of what we're going through. And we give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. Go in peace, and God's blessing be upon each breath here. Amen.